So in this session, we are about to learn how to set up a new book. I mean, do a GST setup. We create more customers, masters, vendors. This is a list of masters that we are about to learn. Then we'll learn something about the transactions of purchase and sales. We'll verify our inventory, and we'll see the accounting part also. Okay. To do this, we'll start with setup of a new book. We'll start Max. You can clarify your doubts in between and be a little audible so that it's recorded. So to set up a new book, we'll just press the shortcut key Alt-Ctrl-Shift-N. Alt-Ctrl-Shift-N. N for Nigeria. Okay, N for new. So while setting up a new book, we'll just give the company name. So let's say we start a new firm saying Max Enterprises. It will even ask for a short name, so it will automatically take the first letter from it. Just keep Max ENT. Starting from the financial year. In India, we are following 1/4 April to March. So by default, it will bring this current financial year as 1/4/2017. The database file name has automatically come as Max 1718. If you want to change, you can just keep, name it to Max ENT also. If you have any logo, you can even select your logo here. Next set of information is asking about the address details here. If we are feeding it all year, then it's okay. If we are not feeding it currently, we can, even after creating the book, we can update the details in the software later. And I'll just mention like a subcaption saying details of address an option for lucky name where in India we, many of them follow some name which has to be printed at the top of the bill. It can be like any god's name also, like where it's useful, it will be printed at the top of the bill or somewhere in the reports. So there's a critical option here now, begin date. What do you term or what do you mean by begin date? Begin date, see, by default it's coming same as the financial year from. Begin date is the date from which we are starting the operations in Max ERP software. Now what is the difference there? Let's say I am opening the store during Diwali in the October month. Then from the date of beginning date only, all your transactions will be allowed. You cannot make any transaction before the beginning date. For example, if you are making any purchases in the month of September and you want to record in the system, then your begin date should be somewhere at the beginning of September. And from this date onwards, whatever, if you're having an existing store, Then from the begin date onwards, all the opening balances you will, I mean, take from the old software as a closing balances, you will carry forward in the Max ERP as on the begin date. No transactions will be allowed before the begin date, and the begin date has to be after the financial year, on or after the financial year, cannot be lesser than the financial year. I cannot go give 1/4/16. Either it will be 1/4/17 or more than that, greater than that. So all the transaction. Now if you've been asked what is the difference between begin date and financial year from, you should have clarity on this. So each of these options on the screen has a purpose. We'll understand this in details. Now business information setup, it is asking what is the currency that is being followed. So if it's India, then we have by default Indian settings here. So if it's some other country, you can define dollars or and the currency symbol, number of decimals places being followed. Certain country follows 3 decimals. In Oman and all, we have clients where they are having 3 decimals. And they have different decimal symbol. The date format that is being followed. So globally there are 3 standards of dates which are being followed. Either EDMMYY or MMBDYY, or certain countries even follows YY-MMBD. So by default everything is standard as per the Indian country measures. Date separator, again someone follows a slash, and by default it's hyphen. So you can have a date separator also in between. Business vertical. See, there are a lot of business verticals which are being mentioned here. Right from apparel, kitchen stores, hardware, whether it's an ice cream chain or department store. So by default it's others. So whatever is the applicable business vertical, you can choose it. And you can click next. It's asking for TIN number, CST, PAN number and all this statutory information. FSSAI is for the food safety and security number, which is being provided to all the restaurants and even the distributors of food related products. They need to sign up with this, and then only they will be allowed to sell those products. Same way, service tax number is for all the service industry. ECC code is all for excise, but moreover, all this information has become obsolete after GST. After GST, it's standard GST number which comes in. FSS number will still be there even after GST, but the 10 CST, PAN number is the personal account number for the company. If it's a proprietorship firm, someone can feed in the PAN number also. We have all these provisions here. So as per the different, the GST numbers are also about to come here. It's not yet updated, but in the coming updates, you will even find a GST option coming here. The tax setup. This tax setup has also become almost obsolete, but the purpose here was for the VAT taxation, where we were about to, we can automatically create the default taxes here, outstation sales and outstation purchases, whether it's a VAT or CST. So even the GST taxation setup will be a part of this new book setup itself after a while, but as of now it's all related to VAT. In VAT, generally how do we create, this is still obsolete, but we can learn on this. Outstation sales can be like VAT or CST. I mean, outstation would be CST. It was CST earlier. So CST 5%. And outstation purchase, or again CST 5% or 14.5%, whatever the tax applicable. Same way, local tax. VAT 14.5%. Hopefully, even if it's 5%, you can create multiple taxes like this. So by default, all these tax classes will get created in the software, and your task would only be to select the appropriate taxes for the respective product. This entire screen, I mean, this whatever we are seeing is obsolete for now after the GST. You just created only for your learning purposes. I'll just click next, and finally, it is just showing a summary, your company name, the financial year from, the location where you are operating from. Say if it's a multi-branch, HO means head office. So branch offices will be BO. So in case if it's multi-branches, rest of the branches you will configure inside the software, not while creating the book. But in book creation, primary head office details, we are updating everything in. The begin date has come, and the currency details and the date, and the default username password is admin. Okay. So with this, your book will get created. Once the book is created, you will find the book being displayed in the first screen of the software. So you'll find the Max Enterprises book has been listed here. What is the other detail which is being showed here? The book name. And then we have the Max entry and the last entry date. So which is never. There's no transaction here. So let's log into this and do the next set of tasks. So the default username password is admin.
Admin.
Now once we log into this, this is the home page. We'll learn something on the settings part. The home page will have a word of wisdom which is common for all the customers for today. It's an automatic. Yeah, one per day. On the left hand side, you have a favorites menu, which is showing you. I mean, user can add his all sort of favorite regular options on this menu. For example, if I am looking at any specific report on a daily basis, I can click add and edit. So there's an add and edit option here. Add or update. And let's say I want to even add the products to this. Products is always a salesperson. Salesperson master to this. I can just select this and save. So along with other favorite menus, I'll even have the salesperson coming in now. Salesperson and agent. What is the advantage? I can click here and quickly open that screen. So rather than searching in different menus, I can have my shortcuts. Same here, support details are there. Where anyone wants support, they can click here and get assistance. The support screen, they can click TeamViewer from here and they can get started. We can connect over TeamViewer. Shortcut keys of the applications are listed here. The general shortcut keys for remote support, for calculator, for logging out. Same way for the masters, transactions. Screen wise we have shortcut keys like F10 for save, F9 for edit, page up, page on for previous, next. This will be useful while the initial stage for any customers also. But these are all general information on the left hand side tab. On the right hand side you have on this side you have information of announcements. Any announcement made will be scrolling here. Plus you have the current date, the username is coming here, last login date will be displayed here. The current financial year in which we are logged in. The customer code, software edition, number of user license plus the current version that is running. Version is being displayed here as well as it is being displayed at the top of the screen also. The current system name, application directory, the database server in which we are connected. We'll learn about the database server and all in other session. So we'll do one thing. First we'll learn about the basic settings. File menu is comprised of all the setups only. Generally clients will not do anything on the file menu, unless we say. But we should be aware of all the setups here on the file menu. So currently with this book, we'll just do certain module configuration details. There are so many modules here. What all is not required, we can just log out and we can enable the required ones only. Let's say we'll enable this order module also. Rotation. After enabling the modules, to see the differences on the menus, you have to close and log in again. So other menus which have been enabled now, all this have come. Okay. So we'll learn different modules in different sessions. Today we'll just begin with the masters, where we'll create customers.
Yes.
Yeah, we need to do the GST setup first. So we'll go to file. Since GST is enabled, got applied in India, we'll first have to set up the GST. It is asking the GST setup date. So it has got applied from 1st July 2017, so by default that date is there. In GST, we have two taxes for local sales. Local salesmen within the state. Within the state, all the taxes are being split into CGST and SGST. And outside state, it will be IGST. There's one more option saying enable tax 3, CESS. This is applicable for certain businesses where like tobacco and alcohol and those kind of businesses, where they'll have extra taxes of additional CESS on that. So that is not enabled by default, because very few businesses would be requiring that. But if it's required, even this can be enabled. For demo purpose,
we'll ask them?
As per the client requirements.
Okay.
If client says I'm dealing with this A rated products, then for them we have to even enable this CESS. So we'll even define the tax classes. Certain businesses have on, they are clear that they have 12% and 5%. So we'll just create two more for them. Certain businesses, they have clarity of 12 and 18. Where in demo purposes, I'll just create all. So as per the client's requirement, we can enable whichever taxes are applicable. In GST, as per India, we have all the tax within this 6 slabs. We are doing just the setup now. And all the GST tax classes are created. See, while creating the book, whatever we created were the VAT classes, which are obsolete now. And from now on, GST tax classes will be applicable. There's one option for print file name also. So as a part of GST setup, we gave the new print formats for all the customers with all GST tax slabs coming in. So there are so many GST things coming in. So we'll just select the default format, GST invoice trading general. And we just click create GST setup. For certain customers, we have even started from bill number 1 after the GST. So we created this option of create new bill series for GST. But since it's a demo company and it's all starting freshly, we need not create this one. Okay, so we are done with GST setup. Next, we'll start the masters. We'll go in details of customers first. Customers and vendors will almost have all the information similar. We'll learn each of these options in the customer master now. So a customer account name. Let's say I give Raj Putana Enterprises. Alias name. What is an alias name? A short code for the customer. So we even have provision where the software can auto-generate a code for every customer, every supplier likewise. So how do we define that? You will see that definition also. For now, I'll just give a code. If required, I can just give an existing code also, like CE 1001. We can search the customer by his name, by his alias code also. What is print name? Again, the same name is coming here, Raj Putana Enterprises. What does this mean? Let's say if I have multiple clients with Raj Putana Enterprises name, the account name has to be unique in the software. So how do I identify my customers? Is, let's say this Raj Putana Enterprises belongs to Mumbai. But in the printout, it should not be coming as Raj Putana Enterprises Mumbai. In printout, whenever we generate a bill, the company name should be Raj Putana Enterprises only. So for that purpose, we'll just remove this Mumbai from here. So print name can be repeated. Across multiple clients, I can have similar print name. But account name, for identifying Raj Putana Enterprises, I have attached a name as Mumbai along with it. Okay. Then next we have account type, general, cash or lead. What does this mean? General means a regular general account, a general ledger, wherein we will be maintaining its balances, plus it might even be visible in trial balance for, I mean, that account will be like a general account itself. The difference between general, cash and lead is, cash accounts are walk-in customers who comes in, who goes out. And their information is just for our marketing purposes. We just keep creating a database for that details. I'll show the application of this in the accounting reports. Because if we have a store with thousands of walk-in customers and we create each customer name and mobile number, while searching for our accounts purposes, all those names also will be listed somewhere in between, which are irrelevant during those times. This is just for database purposes. So if we distinct our customers as general and cash separately, the cash customers will not be listed by default, or won't come in the search list by default, unless we tick that option and bring those in the search. What is a lead? Lead is just an inquiry. Someone has called up asking for certain information, so we have made a note of their contact information as a lead. So lead also will not come anywhere in ledgers and any other details, other reports, except the CRM part. So by default, I'll just keep it as general. Now what is account group? By default, it's saying sundry debtors, consignment or customer accounts. As part of accounting balance sheet, accounting financial accounting part, we have to distinct all our ledgers among certain groups. Customers either can be customer account or sundry debtors. As per the accounting term, it is termed as sundry debtors. But for certain layperson, they can even distinct them as a customer account. And we can create a few more accounts under this if required. We can create our own names also. If we want to distinct our customers as dealers, retailers, wholesalers separately, then we can create three more under this. What is the impact is, while seeing the balance sheet reports and the trial balances, you can group this dealers, see their balances separately. Your retailers can be separate, your customers can be separate. Based on this grouping, your reporting can have a difference. But it won't have any differences at the back end part of accounting, because all three are having the same impact. On the accounting part, all three will have the same effect. So let it be sundry debtors by default, which is coming correctly here. Then next option we have is subgroup. Once we come to subgroup, you find a new option saying press Alt plus N to create new. At the bottom info bar, you can see this. So what is a subgroup now? Further, if you want to categorize all your customers as corporate customers, government, hospitals, or some premium clients or regular clients, you can create different subgroups for, like, let's say I just create one subgroup for Alt N. I'll just create saying can even create like this. See, all these four are actually created here, and it will be listed here now. I will have to refresh the screen in order to get this listed again. But by default, whatever one we create, that will be listed here. Generally, one contact will belong to one subgroup only, but it can be for multiple also. One of my client can be a corporate client as well as can be my friend also. What is the advantage here with the subgroup? I can see all my reports as per the subgroup also. For example, if I want to see total turnover made to my friends, then I can see a separate report, or total outstanding which is from corporate spending, so I can see a separate report, or total profit generated out of corporates, I can see that, I can make generate that report and find out the details. So there can be a number of subgrouping, and one contact can be among multiple subgroups. Tomorrow, if I want to invite, I am keeping some show and I want to invite only the corporate clients, not for all. Then I can just filter corporates, or maybe corporates and my friends or my relatives. I can have one more subgroup saying relatives. So I can just filter corporates, friends and relatives, and only generate or extract those contacts, send SMS to them or take label printouts of them or contact in person. But I can extract those contacts and do whatever I want. So that filtration becomes easier. Remarks. Now for this customer, if you want to have some remarks like just general information, but this remarks will be displayed everywhere while using this contact. For example, clear payment terms before billing. I'm just giving a general term. So this will be an alert which will be shown to me while generating a bill to Rajputana Enterprises. Then next, we have an existing address information. Existing address would be all the existing details that we have added here. One customer can have n number of billing and shipping addresses. For example, let's say Rajputana Enterprises, I'm giving first billing address. Let's say HO number 99. area, let's say state is very essential here. Why state is essential? For tax purposes. Now, as per the state only, the software will be able to recognize whether it's a local client or an outstation client. If it's the same state, how do we define same state? Max Enterprises has given the state information while creating the book, as well as it is available in the file companies. Here you can define the state for the company if the address is not updated. The state for the company and the state for the customer, if it's same, or the vendors also, then it is a local sales. If the state is not matching, then it is an outstation sales. When it's a local sales, while billing, the taxes will be split among two, CGST and SGST. And if it's an outstation sales, then it will come as IGST, a single tax. So let's say we are giving it for Maharashtra now. Zone bar route, what is the use of this? Again, we can have this for the kind of proper follow-up. For example, certain areas are coming in a single sequence. Now, considering Chennai now, let's say if a salesperson is going towards Annanagar. So he can cover like Saukarpet, Veperi, Chulai, Pochwakam, Kilpak, Kellys, Annanagar. So this can be one single belt. So we generally, this is for belt maintenance only, kind of route maintenance, even for delivery purpose as well as for the payment collection purposes. Certain businesses follow this very strongly. It's a very advantageous field for them, where they mention it's on Annanagar belt. So one particular day when they find out a person is going towards Annanagar, they can generate all the bills outstanding for Annanagar only and give a printout to the person. He will see all the entire contacts for right from Saukarpet till Annanagar. All the areas will be covered. For those customers, he can directly visit and collect the payment instead of finding or thinking anything else. As per the zone, it can go. Alternative way could be like Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday also. This zone bar route can even be followed as date wise. So this all customers we need to contact on Monday, because many of this have clear payment terms that payments will be given only on Friday. Certain companies follow payment will be given only on Saturdays or Tuesdays. So likewise, if it's very particular, I mean customer is particular for one particular date, then we can mention the day wise thing also. So whenever we want to take a follow up for Wednesday, we can just select Wednesday and get all the bills for Wednesday and then give a print or follow them up. PAN number of the customer, the contact person there, his mobile number, let's say Mr. I'm just giving a mobile number, fax number, phone number, email ID, let's say info at his website details. The default transport, what is transport and transport mark? So default transport is whenever a bill is being raised to Rajputana Enterprises, the goods are being dispatched through certain transport companies by default. And these transport companies are generally fixed for all the customers, unless it's a local client or unless if it's a new client, we are not knowing it. But generally, whenever there's any billing that happens to Rajputana Enterprises, it will go through some, let's say, Mahalakshmi lorries. Transport mark. Transport mark is just an indication for quick identification. For Rajputana Enterprises, it can be like RE or RE Mumbai or REM. This will be printed on the bill and can be for quick identification only. Transport mark is just for quick identification. Now, this transport companies, whenever a bill is generated, the goods will come as a, when the goods will be parceled in our premises and it will be sent to this Mahalakshmi lorries. So the people in the office premises seeing the bill will know that where it has to be delivered to. And that when they will directly pack the goods and deliver it to the Mahalakshmi lorry guys. Mahalakshmi lorry along with the bill copy, they will know where it has to be delivered. So they have tie-ups with different vendors. See, certain transport companies are dealing only with Mumbai. So they have fixed route like Chennai to Mumbai, maybe Chennai, Andhra and Mumbai. Certain have Chennai, Karnataka and Maharashtra, up to Maharashtra, or someone might be going to Ahmedabad or Rajasthan. So different companies are operating in different routes. So whichever transport company signed up for a particular route, accordingly we will select that. Basically, we are giving business to this transport company guys. after having signed up. So there are a lot of tie-ups like this. And there might be multiple transport vendors also. As per the tie-up, whichever is the best vendor, best rates, best services, that will be signed up. And whatever we have signed up, so this can even be a choice of the customer also. When the customer says that we have this particular guy in Chennai and he delivers properly, whatever it is, that transport name we are going to mention here. It's not having much relevance other than just the printing details for now. So we are just mentioning this here. We'll click save and new. I'll create multiple addresses for this. So this is the billing address that we have created. Maybe I can just create one shipping address also. Shipping address can be like, let's say, can be warehouse or can be directly a branch. Let's say, if there's some other guy on that particular warehouse, you can even mention that detail. There's something called list primary here. This primary is specifically for the primary contact detail for billing as well as one primary shipping address also. So by default, if you don't take this, the first address will always be primary. And if you add the second address and again you take that primary, the first one will go up, the second will become primary. So basically, we are just adding up multiple addresses. So now two addresses have come here, HO for billing, one only address for shipping. I'll just create one more address for shipping purposes. So we'll have a distinction and idea while the sales transaction. That is so I've created three addresses, one billing address, two shipping address. Likewise, we can create n number of billing and shipping addresses. The utility is when there's one head office and multiple branch offices, the orders will always come from head office asking for us to be delivering goods to a particular branch. So while billing, we can select where the bill should be generated for and where the delivery of the goods should happen. So for as per that shipping address, that transport details will come in the picture and that will be in the printout for quick references. The other information here like area, state, city, all these are drop downs. These drop downs are termed as the submasters. What is the advantage? Today I can find out Maharashtra wise total sales or Maharashtra wise outstanding. If let's say I'm one of the associate is traveling to Maharashtra for collecting the payment or taking the orders or just meeting up the customers. So I can extract the contacts of all Maharashtra or specifically from Mumbai or specifically from Dadar itself or from one particular state also. And I extract all these contacts, generate a report, or find out outstanding, so find out total sales of it, compare between different states. All this analysis is possible only when we feed all this master information correctly. The more detailed the masters are, the more options the customers will get in terms of reporting. So, you know, all these masters, if there's any spelling mistake that has happened, we'll see in the next set. Okay, we'll go with the next key contacts. Existing addresses, if you want to edit anything, you can just select the address from here again and that will get loaded here. You can just make the changes. Okay. Next we'll go with the key contacts. Key contacts again, you have same set of existing contacts. You can have multiple contact details there. Let's say designation, let's say marketing. This landline number, this birthday, anniversary, all these details. See, based on all these details, we can generate a CRM report saying the coming week birthdays and anniversaries. And you'll get a single report for coming week or coming month, or you can give the n number of days for next 10 days, next 15 days. And in one click, you can send bulk SMS and emails to them. So likewise, we can have n number of details of contacts in that single company. If someone is there, let's say one more. Advantage here is to just create database and have more information. See, nothing is mandatory here, yet all this information will be useful on a later date. we are going in a lot of details in this, in the key contact. I mean, a lot of information is available to be filled in, and everything is infinite. So, n number of contacts, n number of addresses can be there. Tomorrow, any details required, you can quickly find out that contact person, find out relevant contact person among that customer account, and quickly contact them. Tax details, the next set is all about the statutory information of the customer. So whether it's a unregistered dealer or a in GST we have this 5 categories coming in. It's an unknown dealer, it's a regular GST guy, unregistered GST, composition and consumer. Consumer is the end user. Composition, unregistered and regular GST number, whoever has signed up for GST is under the regular thing. Someone who is not registered for GST is an unregistered customer. Composition is a separate scheme where there's a specific limit of turnover. Below that, they are not paying taxes. They'll have a different way of taxation. But anyways, whatever is the category applicable for the customer, you just mention that detail here and mention that GST number. GST number will be in 15 digits, not digits specifically, 15 characters, alphanumeric number in India. So let's say it will be a random number. I'm just giving something a random. So it will even show an alert if it's not correct. It will be containing a state code first. So Mumbai state code is something different. 33 is belonging to Chennai. State code and then PAN number. This is the format of the GST number. I'm just moving ahead. If it's an e-commerce dealer, you have to take this. It's an e-commerce operator. This information has relevance in the GST returns. While the GST returns is being done, there will be certain details connected to this. Again, TIN number, GST number, these are obsolete. What is taxation method? This is still active. Taxation method is whether we are dealing with the customer and applying rate plus tax or net rate or no tax. What does this mean, rate plus tax?
Plus the tax is extra.
For example, if we are selling a product at 100 rupees with 5% GST, then it will be 100 plus GST, 105 rupees would be billed out. If it's net rate, and when we bill the customer rate as 100 rupees, the 100 rupees is inclusive of taxes, so it will automatically segregate as 96 point something, and the balance would be the taxes. So your grand total of the bill would be 100 rupees including the GST. What is the default tax code that should come for the customer? So default tax code here again it's almost obsolete because in GST everything is based on the state and there's no need of defining the GST, I mean the CST taxes or default VAT taxes now. Drug license number is for pharmaceutical businesses or whoever is dealing with medical products. So they need to sign up a drug license and they need to renew that every year, the licenses. Whatever is the license number they mentioned here and the drug license expiry date will be mentioned here. Someone whose drug license has expired, we are not supposed to buy goods from them. So there will be a renewal and the clients will be updating. I mean, they will be renewing it on a regular basis. So you need to keep a track of their license number and the expiry date. So tomorrow this even has to be in the printout, the drug license number of the customer. This is belonging to the excise details again, ECC number, division, commission rate, range. But this is also obsolete now. Because after GST even excises went out, I mean, we have only one taxes now, everything is coming into GST. Any insurance policy if they have, then insurance policy number also will be as a part of tax details. Next we'll move to the other details. We can just click proceed here or we can just click that. Other details we have, first thing is referred by. Again an extra information which we can store for our database purposes only. Who has referred as this customer? If it has come from Just Dial or come from Google or from friend or known contact, you can mention whatever it is. Let's say we just mention it's Google. Date of incorporation. From which date are you dealing with this customer? So let's say we're dealing with this customer from last 3 years or 4 years or maybe in the current year itself. What will happen? What is the purpose of this date of incorporation? Two things. One is, we can find out, there's a report saying new customers report. So based on the date of incorporation, we can find out how many customers have we enrolled in last 30 days, last 15 days, n number of days. So based on the date of incorporation, we'll get to know that. Secondly, if we are dealing with this customer, next year we'll get a reminder saying it's been 1 year since we are dealing with each other. So we can either introduce some promotions or offer to the customer, or you can just send a general SMS also. Based on this also, you can get that report, reminder report. The next important section is the credit days and the credit limit. Important part. What is credit days? What is credit limit? So by default, I'm willing to give 30 days for payment for this customer. So this is the credit days. Beyond 30 days, I'm not willing to, I mean, unless the payment comes, I'm not willing to sell more. Same way, credit limit. And so I'm willing to trust up to 1,50,000 rupees for this customer. Beyond this, the system will start showing me alert. So if I'm selling any goods worth up to 1,50,000, let's say the first bill I have generated for 40,000 and the second bill I have generated for 1,00,000. Third bill I'm trying to generate for 20,000. The third bill, by default, it will show an alert saying you are crossing the credit limit of 1,50,000 rupees. Or even if it's a single bill and you're crossing more than 150, it will show you an alert. Same way, if there's any bill for which the payment has not yet come beyond 30 days. Let's say I've raised a bill for this customer 30 days ago. Today is, let's say, the 35th day. And I'm trying to raise a bill again. It will show me an alert saying the last bill payment has not yet come. So you still want to bill. So by default, it's all in alert mode where it will alert the user. And user can just select yes and proceed. There are certain settings in the software where you can configure whether it should block or it should blindly allow, or you will define this customer wise. Where those setting comes, that will be as a part of account master setup. You have something account master setup here. See, here we are defining, we can define the mandatory fields, whichever fields which are compulsory to be filled in. See, when we rely on people, there is a tendency where during operations they might forget to fill the GST number or certain state or some compulsory mandatory fields. So at the master level itself, we can define whichever fields are mandatory. So all the master fields, let's say mobile number and email ID, should be there always for any contact, otherwise it won't allow you to save the contact. So whatever mandatory setup you do here, that will become a mandatory on the screen before saving. Validations, there's few other things like duplicate TIN bar GST number, whether it should be allowed or not. Certain customer says it should be allowed. For many of them, they'll say no, it should not be allowed. So by default, it says block duplicate. If you give yes, then it will not allow same GST number coming for any other account also. This will help you avoid mistakes, but by default it is no. Because sometimes one same customer can be your supplier also and a customer also. You might have to create two different accounts for them. So in that scenario, same GST number might come twice. Or one same customer having 10 branches and we are maintaining 10 different customer accounts for them. That branch accounts is with that branch, this branch account is with this branch, but they all together have a single TIN number. One customer, 10 branches, all branches are maintaining their account separately, all will place their order separately, but having single TIN number, GST number. So that way, by default, it's no. Credit days exceed, what should happen? So by default, you can see all these are alert. So credit days exceed, whether it should allow, alert, or block. See, sometimes when customer says credit days allowed, it should accept, but credit limit, it should block. So I can give this. But when we give this block, what happens is, for all the customers, it will block. If I have 100 contacts as 100 customers, for all customers, this is applicable altogether. This fourth option here available saying account wise. When I give this account wise, with every customer, it will allow me to select whether it should allow, alert, or block. So let's say I just give this account wise, same with this also account wise. Deal expiry exceed. What should happen? It should show alert or allow. So we need to update that expiry dates again in our system also. By the drug license, which we just saw in the taxation part. And same way, the limit on single payment maximum amount. So that we even have an option, which I'm coming up to, whether a single payment limit should be more than 20,000, 50,000, you can define a limit for the customer. And if the payment is going beyond that, whether it should allow, alert, or block. So by default, it's an alert mode. We even saw the setup of alias.
Yeah.
Where I said to you that the software can automatically define a customer code for all the contacts. So let's say, so it's saying alias prefix and suffix. we'll take for the customers first. The customers prefix, it's starting from seed. Seed is the first number through from which you want to get started. So let's say I want to get started from 1. And then there are some general options saying what is the length. If I give 4, it will be C1004. 1001, sorry, not 4. Length is the number of numbers that you want after the, I mean, total length. Now here it will be like, we have given C for the customers, starting from C, and I mentioned 1 year, and the length is 4. So what will be the output?
C1001.
No. It will be C0001. And I'll even add a suffix saying, let's say, RE. If you want a suffix, okay. Otherwise, suffix will be added after the numbers. Prefix will be before the numbers.
Okay.
This is throughout the application where even for voucher series also we can define this. Even for our bill numbers, we can have a prefix and a suffix. Even for barcode numbers also, we can have a prefix and a suffix. And we can change it from time to time for every year if you require. I'll repeat this once again. See, we have customer alias prefix as C and we are given seed as 1. Seed is nothing but the starting number.
Okay.
And then we have mentioned the length of the code. So length I have given as 4.
Okay.
So prefix C, length, since it has to be 4 and since it is starting from number 1, yeah, it will append 3 zeros in the beginning.
Yeah.
So C0001, that is becoming 4 and the prefix is being appended. Suffix will also be appended after that. Same way for the suppliers, I can have like S1001, if I just, I mean 1001. If I want 1001 means I have to give seed as 1000.
Mm-hmm.
Then it will keep adding 1 to the seed and it will keep generating new numbers. Got it?
Mm-hmm.
Same way for the transporters also, I can have D. I will just save this. So all the settings are all general settings only. You should know about all this information. Account profile setup is relevant with the one of the job work module. Once we learn that module, we'll come to this part. Enable regional language. Regional language is nothing but so we can have this. Now in Tamil Nadu, we want many of the customers say that even the product name and the customer name should come in Tamil for quick identification for the people on the for the bill printout. Universal languages are supported in the Max now. Tomorrow if we have someone in, let's say, Dubai, and they want in that Arabic or their particular regional language. So we can have an option of regional language where just the account name can be converted or translated to that regional language and we can print out. So we'll see this part also as a regional language. I'll just enable this and we'll save this. So coming back to this, credit days and credit limit I have defined. Whatever is the setting change that we do, we need to close the screen and open it again for it to refresh. So the screen is still open, we have all these windows opening here, the home page is here and we have the customer screen. Once we close and open it again, we'll find two new options coming here where with every account we'll be able to define whether for this customer credit day should be allowed, alert or block. Same with credit limit, allow, alert or block. Then next we have something called price list. What is price list? We can maintain multiple price lists in the software. For example, for all the corporate customers, let's say for a product XYZ, my purchase value is 100 rupees. For a retail customer, I'm selling at 150. For a corporate customer, since the payment may be a little delayed after 6 months, I might sell at 170, 180. So I can have different rates for different price lists. I can maintain multiple price lists, like for hospitals, separate amount pricing. For government, that might be separate. For corporates, might be separate. For wholesale dealers, might be separate. For retail end user customers, might be separate. I can create n number of price lists, and with each price list, I can maintain different rates for the products. Whether it can be a discount on a sales rate, or it can be a direct sales rate, or it can be a separate percentage above the cost rate also. We term it as markup and markdown. We'll come to that again later. And I can link that price list with this particular customer. If it is a corporate customer, I can just select a corporate price list here and save it. What will happen while billing the user, once he selects Rajputana Enterprises Mumbai, the corporate pricings will get started applied automatically. The user need not think what pricing should be applied. The owners or the administrators at the back end can define the price list, can define different rates, and the user on the counter, without any disturbance, even without any knowledge, he can just select the account name and he can start billing, and accordingly the prices will be applied for that. The owner need not be on the store or in front of the screen. Okay. Next we have option for grade. Grade is nothing but we can just define our customers or categorize our customers in some general grade, like regular, normal, premium, or maybe some A, B, C, D, E. This is just an additional filtration options based on which we can generate different reports. After grade, we have industry. See, both this grade and industry are purely for filtering contacts. Let's say this particular customer is into sanitary wares or tiles and ceramics. I can just create different things here. As a customer, I can just define their industry purely for database purposes only. Again, I can contact, or if tomorrow I have any requirement of tiles and ceramics, I will try contacting my customers first. Or I can extract the contacts and I can put some scheme for them. Cash discount and special discount. So by default, we can have a cash discount for every bill for this customer. We want 5% to be given default discount. So I can have first discount. Same way, special discount or scheme discount, whatever you term it as. The second discount also, you can define that the percentage is here. Whenever the bill is being raised for Rajkumar Enterprises, 5% discount will come automatically. Enable MRP based billing, discount on MRP, this is a separate concept here. Again, this is not very important for this, but MRP based billing is while creating all the products, we are defining a sales rate and we are even defining the MRP for the product. So generally there will be different rates. MRP might be, let's say, 1000 rupees and our selling rate would be 900 rupees. We are always selling lesser than MRP. Now certain businesses operate in a different way. They go with MRP based billing fixed, plus they will give some discount on MRP. For this customer, MRP, I have 5% discount on MRP. For one more customer, MRP based billing, but I'll give 10% discount on MRP. So all the bills will have MRP values coming, and the sales side will be arrived after the discount on MRP. Default salesperson who is associated for Rajputana Enterprises. Now the salesperson can be an agent who has introduced us to this customer, who is taking commission, or someone from within the premises who is handling this account. So let's say I just give us Suresh. And the salesperson commission. Let's say for Suresh has went to the market and found this customer for us, and for every transaction for this, so sometimes it can even be an interior guy or some other agent who has brought us this customer, and for every transaction of this customer, he will ask for a percentage. So he, as per his terms, maybe he might be billing little higher to that customer, and he might say, let's say 5% commission for every transaction to Rajputana Enterprises. The same salesperson can have different percentage for different account also. Tomorrow he might bring one more, let's say medium scale client. For him it might be 2% for every transaction. So these agents, there are many people in as an agent who find out customers and link it and get the businesses and get then their revenue is purely about this commission. Same way we have a second option saying influence account and commission percentage. What is influence and its commission? Influence account is something like, again, a salesperson and agent in between, but after every transaction, immediately that amount of percentage will get as an outstanding, it will become as a payable to that particular account. It will start maintaining a ledger for it. So for a particular XYZ customer or Rajputana Enterprises, let's say Suresh is in an influence account. Based on Suresh only, we are getting all the transactions. So if there's a dealing for 1 lakh rupees, 5000 rupees will go to Suresh account automatically. It will show as payable. It will immediately start affecting to the accounts. Tomorrow at the end of the month, Suresh comes and says, give me my statement for the entire month. We will have a ledger for Suresh where all this 5000 for this transaction, 2000 for this transaction, all the transactions will be listed. And once we make a payment to the Suresh also, it will again adjust it against those transactions while making the payments. Only the pending ones will be remaining in this ledger. Basically, it will maintain like a bill outstanding for Suresh. So this is not very actively used in the market, but we still have that feature in the software. Then we have next thing is terms. What are terms? We can customer-wise, you can have multiple terms and condition. Like for this customer, payment 50% in advance, 50% upon delivery or something. Or maybe payment within 15 days or 100% upon delivery or 100% in advance. We can create different terms and assign the respective terms for this customer here. We have a separate master screen where we can create all the terms and then link those terms here. So while raising any sales order or while the bill is generated, these terms will get printed for this customer. We are coming till that filtration level. Next, we'll give it proceed. You can have n number of bank details for the customer. If the customer is having 3 accounts, 4 accounts, you can have all this information listed here. Just for our information purposes, we can quickly find out what all accounts the customer is handling. There's one option saying return. See, again, existing banks will be list of all the banks account that we have created for our ad if you want to edit anything. And there's an option saying check return charges for the dealer. We can have clear terms with the customer. If there's any check bounce, then we'll be charging 500 rupees or 400 rupees, whatever it is. Maybe our bank is charging us 250, 300 only, but if we define 500 rupees here, any check bounce happens, 500 rupees will get additionally appended to his outstanding. Whereas our bank is charging us 300 rupees, this 200 rupees would be an additional service charge that we are billing. So this can also be predefined here. Then finally we have settings. Settings like stop transaction. Now tomorrow we don't no more want to deal with this particular customer. We can just click the stop transaction, type a reason here and save it. So whenever the user on the counter is billing, let's say if I have a big business and I'm having 25 systems, so I cannot control which customer is coming on which counter and what is he doing. But at the back end, if I do these operations, then whether customer send his employee or anyone to buy the goods, on the counter when Rajkumar Enterprise is selected, it will show that it cannot be billed. It will not allow you to bill. It will not allow you to select this name along with the reason that we define here. Set as inactive. What is the purpose of it? This account will no more be listed in the search. Basically, it's becoming an inactive account. What is the difference between stop transaction and inactive? Stop transaction will completely block out. But again, if you remove the stick, it will allow you to do it again. Inactive will hide the customer name in the search list. It will no more allow you. It will take this off. You will still be able to see the ledgers and all the other transactions will be allowed, but inactive will hide the names from the list. Maintain bill wise. What is maintain bill wise?
Adjustment will be done according to the
bill to bill. See, now if I am generating 10 bills for this customer, first bill amounting 15,000, second bill let's say 45,000, third bill 75,000, fourth bill again 20,000. Generally, all businesses operate where the payment will also come for each bill. They'll give first check for 15,000 only, which will be adjusted against first bill will be settled. Why is this bill wise? Now, when we are giving some 30 days credit to a customer for each bill, first bill is raised for let's say 1st October, and the credit is up to 1st November. Second bill may be of 5th October, and credit is still 5th November. So, when we are adjusting this way, maintain bill wise will help us in adjusting the first bill first. Basically, we are taking customers. Sometimes customer will say that for today's bill, for 50,000 rupees, I'm giving immediate payment. You settle that bill. Don't settle any old bills. Then the old bill remain old. But this bill will be settled immediately. So maintain bill wise will help you adjust the bill amount against each transaction. Then next we have used both for sales and purchase. What is the use of it? The same account can be our customer also and can be our supplier also. Let's say a neighbor store. Sometimes we are buying from him and sometimes we are even selling to him. So when by default all the customers will be listed in your sales screen, in your sales return screen as well as in the receipt screen, because it's only dealing with sales returns and receipts. We are not making payments to the customer, neither we are purchasing from the customer. So your search list is by default filtered. You have more clarity while doing the transaction. But in scenarios where you are buying as well as selling to a particular customer only, you take this and this customer will be listed while payments also, while purchase also, while sales also, all these three modules. We have certain dashboard report in which we can find, add to dashboard is the purpose. In this dashboard report, this current customer outstanding will always be listed on the screen, in front of the screen. Let's say you have some top 10 clients for whose outstanding or house turnover you want to see always in the dashboards. So while in the dashboard report, you can quickly see this. What is the current balances or outstanding of this particular account. Then single payment limit. When we receive from this customer, how much is the maximum amount that we receive? So we can just limit things here. Like we don't, generally it's useful for the payment rather than more into receipts. For the vendors, we should not make payment more than 50,000 at a time and in one check. We can limit that way. Same way is for the receipts also. We should not receive more than particular amount for a customer. This is generally not used. We can receive. Next is interest rate. What is interest rate? For all the bills which are more than the outstanding days now. Let's say I have given a limit for 30 days and you have not made payment for 60 days. So for the rest 30 days, remaining 30 days, I will charge you an interest for 12% or 10%. So what are, this report also will be generated from the software. Whichever bills which have went beyond the due days, how much interest should be collected from the customer, that detail will be coming as a part of interest rate. It will automatically calculate the interest for those bills and will give you the total customer wise. So we'll just save this and quickly see the other options here. So this one customer we have created, I'll just close the screen and refresh it again, open it again so that we see the other options of account wise, credit days, entitlement. So these are key parts here. Now with credit days, let's say I click search and I can select Rajput on the enterprises C1001. Either I can search this way or I can search, since wildcard search is on, I can even search like this, Mum Raj. It is still searching. As well as I can search by the mobile number 989898. It will still search. As well as I can search by the GST number also 33ABP. GST number is listed here. You can see all this information. This is a search key. This is also for search. The alias is for search and the name wildcard search. So once we select this, it will allow us to edit. If the user has the edit permission, you can go back here. And in the other details that we saw, see, one is we did not define the subgroup, so I can just select that is as corporate friend also as well as in my and the corporates as well as friends. It belongs to two subgroups. So whenever I am fetching any details for corporates, this name should come. Whenever I am searching anything for friends also, this should come. Secondly, I can the credit days, what should happen? Since I have given account wise, if it's 30 days credit days, it should alert. But if the credit limit of 1,50,000 is crossed, it should block billing. Able to get? So either we can define globally for all the customers, or I can come to account wise settings also, where with each account I can define this. Industry is there, and that's what I'm just saving this. See, regional name also we did not see. We've enabled the setting, which is enabled now. So I can translate this. In translate, you'll find some. A new window opening. Rajputana Enterprises Mumbai. So while translation is asking which language we want to translate to. Let's say if I select just Tamil, there are two options here, translate the meaning or transliterate. By default we want a transliterate only, we don't want the meanings. When we give convert all words, it is bringing this in Tamil language, Rajputana Enterprises. Same way if I just give Hindi or Marathi or Gujarati, whatever it is, in all those languages, what is bringing in Hindi, Rajputana Enterprises. I can just click proceed and save. So this will come in the printout as a Hindi name. Same way for the products also, you have a regional settings name where we can give a regional name to it. So when many of these customers in local and somewhere in the outside of the small towns, they will ask in their regional name because their customers might not know to read. So they will at least expect their name and the product names to be in them. Numbers they will be able to judge, but they will not be able to make up with the name. So whatever is the name that we give, it's not. We have two options for conversion. Either it's a phonetic conversion where it's the same spelling spelled in Tamil or Hindi, as well as we have an option for change in meaning also. When we rice, when we type as rice in the product name, it will change to RC when we translate to meaning. But if it's phonetic, it will type it as rice only. Okay. Few other options here at the bottom is attached documents. We can have n number of documents attached with each of the contacts. Maybe if we have some terms, we can print envelope from here for this contact. For envelope printing, we need to set up the envelope design first. Attached documents can have n number of documents, maybe some certificates or some agreement between us. That can be scanned and we can either get it from a webcam, you can keep the image in front of it, or you can scan it from a scanner, or you can add and browse and select the the detail that you want. I can save it. So n number of attachments can be done. Merge. What is the use of merge? Let's say we mistakenly have created two Rajputana enterprises Mumbai, two accounts. One on this counter, that guy made this Rajputana without spelling. Let's say one has created Rajputana Enterprise, one has created Rajputana Enterprises. Two accounts have been created and it's managing two parallel accounts. But it's finally one customer. So we can click merge, select the from account, the from one, whom, and select the two account from which name to which name. The two name would be the one which will remain in the system. From name, after the merge, we can delete. Okay. From account A to account B, we click merge, all the transactions will get merged. And account A, we can delete after the merge. If there's any single transaction left for any of the account, it won't let you delete that account. Even if there's an opening balance associated to an account, we cannot delete it. There's even a single pro forma or a quotation also sent to a customer. You have to delete the quotation first and then only you'll be able to delete the account. Basically, if there's any transaction relevance left with that account or it's associated with the account, you have to delete all those transaction details first and then you'll be able to delete the main account. Opening balances will always have to be merged manually. That's the message here. So mistakenly Rajputana Enterprise, there's an opening balance 25,000. Again Rajputana Enterprise, again you mentioned 25,000. After the merge also opening balances, you have to edit manually or you have to remove that name from the opening balances, then only you'll be able to delete the wrong one. Okay. Clear with this? So final thing is change group. What does this mean? An accounting group remains fixed for each of the contact. Let's say mistakenly a vendor has been created in the customer and you want to change it. So once you click change group, it will show you, which group do you want to change to. Whether it's a extended creditors or a supplier account, basically a vendor. You can change it and accordingly it will shift to that particular screen. Or if you want to create sundry data as your customer account, then you can just change the group to customer account. Balance sheet impact will both be remain same, but for reporting purposes, you can generate separate report for customer accounts. Now once you click new and again come back to this Rajputana Enterprises, this belongs to customer accounts now. Where do we create all these new groups? Under masters, account submasters, we have an option of creating account groups, subgroups. Now this 4 or 5 subgroups that we have created will already be here. Same way, if there's any spelling mistake in an area or you have created same name as two areas, like say Borivali and some Borivalis, or spelling mistake is there, you can merge two areas and again delete the one which is not required. Same way, city, postal code, whichever are the drop downs that you are seeing in the screen behind, all these drop downs are available here. So instead of going to each contact and changing the area name, you just rename the area here itself, all the contacts linked with the area will automatically get updated. Same way, designation, referral, grade, industry, all the drop downs, transport, zone, country, whatever you found there in the background screen on the masters related to accounts, all this are available as a drop down option here. For example, let's say Borivali double L is there, I want to change it to a single L. So I can just select area name as Borivali, add it, and change it to single L and save. Now once again you come back to this contact and select Rajputana Enterprises, the spelling is changed. So for all the contacts wherever this area was mentioned, the spelling would have got updated. Merging and renaming is possible through submasters only. Rather than going with each contact and changing the name, it will be too tedious for you. So that's all with customers. We'll see the vendors and other masters in the next session. Okay, let's stop here. Thank you.